December the 11th, 1993. In Kuala Lumpur's Ampang district, Highland Towers Block 1 collapses. An unknown number of residents are trapped in the wreckage. The nation's fire service, the Bomba, is first to respond.
Lebih kurang pukul 1:30, terima panggilan kejadian bangunan runtuh Highland Tower. Kita orang pun terus menuju ke tapak Highland Tower yang tumbang. Bila tiba di sana, saya terkejutlah dan tergamamlah.
The firefighters confront a scene of unparalleled destruction. Thousands of tons of steel and reinforced concrete look as if they had been flattened by the swipe of a vengeful giant's hand. From the ruins comes a shrill symphony of car alarms. For the Bomba team, the collapse of an entire apartment block is the biggest challenge they have ever faced.
When the first Bomba guys came along, for like a few seconds, they just looked at the building and they had, I guess they had no idea what to do. I mean, they've probably never seen this before.
The Bomba team have good reason to proceed with care. The disaster site is potentially a death trap.
Saya dengan kawan-kawan saya rasa perlu membuat satu-satu untuk menyelamat mangsa. Jadi kita buat pencarian rambang di sekeliling bangunan. Tapi kita takut dia nak masuk bangunan itu sebab bangunan itu unstable.
The whole structure was still creaking and groaning. Shards of concrete were breaking off constantly, so you were showered from bits and pieces. Because the whole building was still in flux, I mean, it could have at any stage, to be quite honest, suddenly collapsed itself.
Ada bau kuat, bau petrol dengan LPG, gas masak, dan bangunan itu pun masih bergerak lagi. Mana masih berbunyi prap.
The worst danger that the rescuers face is a consequence of the way the two linked towers of Block 1 collapsed.
The front part of the building, as we knew it when it was in the air, had been crushed to less than a meter or maybe a meter and a half thick. The other part of the building stood up like a, you know, like a fishbone, and all the floors still erect, but when they should have been horizontal. Phenomenal.
These fish bones, the upended floors, are now vertical walls that threaten to collapse on top of the rescuers if they try to enter the structure. The hazardous state of Block 1 is just one anxiety for the rescue team. Looming over the site are the other two towers, and it's feared that they might come crashing down at any moment. Police officer Zaman Khan makes a decision to have them evacuated immediately.
We thought it is safer to evacuate everybody from the other two buildings.
Occupants of Highland Tower, Block B and Block C, please vacate the safe blocks because it is considered unsafe now.
As the rescuers battle to come up with a strategy, distraught relatives begin to gather at the site. The sheer horror of what has taken place is overwhelming.
So a lot of the family members were there and total shock, total disbelief. Just how can this happen to me? Where are my loved ones?
Block 1 resident Dr. P.G. George returns to find his wife and two daughters are missing.
We saw Dr. George, and he could hardly walk with people holding him. And in a way, that's what really brought home what had happened.
Zarif Afandi, who has been searching desperately for his brother and sister, provides a single piece of good news. His siblings are safe.
They went out, luckily, but the sand went on top of them. But my mate, they were...
The biggest relief, you know, you're like, oh, my God.
When So Chai Hock, deputy director of Malaysia's fire service, reaches the disaster site, he has no illusions about the challenge his men now face and the urgency of their task.
In my 30 years of operation, I have never seen such a huge collapse of a building.
The bomber team lacked the specialized equipment needed to deal with a building collapse on this scale. But So Chai Hock orders his men into action.
The fire service was ill-equipped for such a job. We do not have the specialized equipment to cater for such a disaster. But we cannot stand here seeing to do nothing. We gave everything. We went in and we tried to take the people out.
So I went up together with some firemen using the ladder. And then we were looking around. I told the man, careful, but look around just in case there are survivors.
Almost at once, firefighter Mahendran Munyandi hears the sound that they all desperately hope to hear, a human cry for help.
Jadi bila naik, saya pergi ke dalam, saya jerit. Halo, halo, eh? Kalau ada siapa-siapa kan? Then saya dengar bunyi.
Mahendran finally tracks down the sound to the remains of the sixth floor.
Bila kita sampai ke suara itu, kita nampak ada satu seorang mangsa dah ditimbuh dengan dinding, menutupi separuh badan dia. Kita dapati nak mengangkat tembok itu satu masalah. Dia pun tolak.
The trapped woman is a Japanese national called Shizui Nakajima. She has been terribly injured.
Badan dia kebiru-biruan. Lepas itu kita tunggu bantuan sampai di atas stretcher. Kita tunggu di bawah lebih kurang setengah jam.
As the rescuers struggle to free the stricken Shizui, they hear a second cry, but it's hard to locate where the sound is coming from.
We heard tolong, tolong like that, but we were looking around. It's all rubble and all that.
Then one of the rescue team spots a stick being poked through the rubble. As they begin digging, a heart-rending sight confronts the rescuers.
I was surprised. There was this baby and the mother. So we took the baby out, and I was so surprised that there was no injuries on the baby.
The baby, Noor Hamida, just 16 months old, is soon safe in the hands of her rescuers, and apparently unfazed by her astonishing escape. Meanwhile, the bomber men have at last freed the injured Japanese woman, Shizui. A crane has reached the site, and she is delicately lifted to safety. Later, the mother of the rescued baby is at last winched to freedom. She is an Indonesian maid called Umi Rashida, who had been trapped inside an apartment when the building collapsed. Rescue teams and waiting relatives, the deliverance of these three survivors is electrifying.
We were quite happy at that time, thinking that the rest could be found.
But the rescuers now face a problem. No one can account for how many people were in Block 1 when it collapsed.
Obviously, the numbers, it was a total unknown. It could have been anything from 150 down to zero. Obviously, people were going to be there because it was still a lunchtime on a Saturday. So, but we didn't know how many. We just really didn't initially.
And an even more urgent question is, are any still alive?